There's a word for that. Somewhere in there.
Don't ask me.
Exactly. Have you been in Texas? Is that where you've been? Or you've been in New York? Or you've been everywhere?
I've been in North Pole, opening the movie, doing a premiere for my friends, the Penguins. They love the movie, by the way.
Javier Claus, is that the...
No, I've been in New York. I just, not landed, but yesterday. Yeah, and I, the cold weather of there and the warm weather of this makes something funny in my head. It's like, where am I now?
That's, well, Los Angeles does that for everybody, I think.
Yeah, right.
Even when things are good. So do you spend much time in Los Angeles through all of this?
Yeah, I mean, I always see Los Angeles like the office. You know, it's a place you go there to work, and then but you live in somewhere else. Mm-hmm. I live in Madrid.
Much happier over there.
I don't know. It's my people. It's my city. It's my country. It's where family and friends are. I like it there. I mean, it's a nice place to live. I think it's a great. There's a great food. Mm-hmm. People is they usually have a great sense of humor. I don't know, but it's a country. It's a city. Like
yeah,
all of them.
So you get everything.
Exactly.
Like Barcelona.
Like Barcelona, exactly.
Yeah, and you shot this in almost all, you shot all of this on locations in Barcelona?
Yeah, but Biutiful is not shot in locations, actually. They are real places. Oh. So we never construct a set. All of them were real places where real things were going on. Like, the, for example, the illegal factory of, the illegal Chinese factory, that was an illegal Chinese factory for real. Mm. That it was dismantled weeks before, months before, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. And then we go in there and we shoot in there. Mm-hmm. And actually some of the Chinese people that are in that scene, sleeping and living there, mm-hmm. were actually living for real in the real one. Oof. And they, I mean, so they weren't, they went through the real stuff. Mm-hmm. They went through the real stuff.
So did Alejandro set it in Spain for you? Was that part of the agreement?
No, I don't think so. I think he really wanted to come back and do something in Spanish. And I guess because he thought of me doing the role, he thought that Barcelona would be a good place to shoot it. It could have been perfectly Madrid also. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think he chose Barcelona because it's more, I don't know, because it's on the sea. I mean, there's more life going on there.
And the bell rings.
And the bell rings. Hopefully, it will be not a tax man. I'm paying my taxes.
They're bringing you a big box of cash. That's good. How you get paid now. So, how do you and Alejandro start this journey? Because it's such a intense, everything about it. I mean, you put yourself so far out there in this picture, and yes. I think he pushed himself harder than he's ever pushed himself before. Mm-hmm. Where do you guys start?
He came to me with a. With a script that is red, because he doesn't want the pages to be photocopied. How do you say photocopy?
Yeah, that was it.
So all the script is red, and that was scary to see. Like, there's a lot of meat in there, man. I read it like three times, and then I realized that he was proposing me something different than a performance. He was proposing me a life journey, and that's what we did. We said, okay, we commit ourselves to go with the character, and it took us through different and difficult places until we achieved the end. And it was 5 months of shooting, some days 6 days per week, 12 hours per day, sometimes 14 hours. Mm. It was hard for me to be in that emotional state for so long. It was hard.
So do you look for life journeys? Is that part of what you want as an actor, or you can do one every 3 years, or you know, and then do a Woody Allen movie?
Exactly, eat, pray, love.
Yeah.
Yes, I like characters that go through difficult situations. Let's put it this way, because in there, you see a person who really has to face himself, the worst and the best of himself. And are those characters the ones that I really pay more attention to when I go to a movie theater? Mm-hmm. I mean, I like also entertaining movies and comedies and all that, but there are certain roles where I think read a lot of things to the audience. Like, it reads a lot to a lot of people, and those are the ones that I look for, yeah.
So, is the experience, I mean, is it the experience of making the movie? Is it what you know will be the outcome that you're after? What is it that is turning you on?
For example, in Biutiful, I knew from the very beginnings, after reading the script, that it will be a lot of involvement of myself in an emotional and psychological and physical way. Until the moment where I knew that it would do a different, a weird click on my head, and I will become him. Because there's no way you can pretend that. There are so many layers, there are so many things going on, there are so many hard circumstances, things that you have to apply and to be able to show it and express it from a very honest way, that I, myself, I don't know others, but me, I don't know how to do that without being there, and being that person for that long. That was the hard part. And that's the life journey that really spit you out after the movie in a different way. Like, you come back home like being a different person because of the things you've seen, the things you've touched in yourself, and the things that you were able to witness also in the other's journey.
So have you had this experience more than once?
No, I think this is the heaviest one because it was so long. I mean, the attention, the focus, the concentration that I had to have for so long, holding that emotional state, it was really exhausting, but it was worth it. I think that's when you wonder and you ask yourself, is it worth it? I think it is. I think it is because that's why I do what I do, because I have the need to express myself through a character. I'm not a painter, I'm not a musician, I need a character to express myself, and Uxbal is one of the best characters ever for any actor.
So are you wrestling with Alejandro through this? Is he pushing you to go further, or does he even need to once you find your zone?
We found ourselves, and we found that he likes to go to the bone, and I am ready to go for it also. So let's say that somebody should stop us. Like, we will go far and far and far, and we won't have limits. And that's dangerous, because then you can find yourself totally lost in the fiction, rather than in control of knowing what's real and what is not. And I guess he went through a different journey. He's a director. He has to be with me, but he has to be with a lot of things at the same time.
Yeah,
I have to be only with my character. And that's, I would say, was 5 months. In the second month, I cross the line, and I put myself in a different place where I would feel what he feels, I would say what he says, until a moment where you are aware that you are not acting or reacting to the real world by the way you are, but by the way he is, but you cannot control it. And that is schizophrenia, is one part of the journey for an actor.
So do you...
I don't know if it's schizophrenia. It's about being really able to inhabit somebody else's.
So do you keep your real world, your real life, at an arm's length when you're in the process of doing something like this?
Let's say that there is no real world. When it's so long and so heavy and so demanding, because I am in every frame of it, there's no room for real world, because you're 6 days per week, and on Sundays you have to prepare the next week. So yes, you can have a drink with a friend, but your face is going to be Uxbal face. They are not having fun with you. It's like, go home. That's the interesting part, but also the part that you have to take care and pay attention to, not be, taken by it in a way that is dangerous for yourself.
Well, he's so in so many dark places, and yet is primarily an empath. I mean, he is emotionally available to everybody all the time, which must be its own kind of draining, even though it makes him a very nice guy in a lot of ways. It has to be exhausting to have your antennas up all the time.
What I'm saying here is not, I'm not saying this something like I'm putting a medal in my chest, like I did it.
Right.
Look how good I am. I'm saying this because I want to share it with the viewer that sometimes when you are acting a fiction comes reality for the one who acts it, who does it. and how important it is to be able to come in and come out out of it. And we, I mean, I'm going to act, my acting teacher, my acting school since 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. Every year I go, at least 3 months. We all know and we all learn how to get in, but there are not many teachers that teach you how to get out of it when the character you are portraying is like Hook's ball, right, for so long and so heavy. It took me a good, I don't know, 6-7 months after the movie finished to really be able to distinguish what is mine and what is still his. And I'm not saying that that's the good way to go, right, that that's good or bad. I'm saying that that happens sometimes. And in this case, it happened more than ever to me.
So did you work during that period? Were you shooting another movie?
No. And once I came out of it, they offered me Eat, Pray, Love, and I said, I'm going there, man. I'm going to Bali with Julia and drive boats. Because it's exactly the opposite of what I was going through for so long.
So you were healing up during that process?
Exactly. No, it was a healing process, really. I mean, I felt so good. I felt like I was coming back into the job again from a different perspective, doing a different tone, stretching some other acting muscles. And I was like, okay, here I am again. No? When at the very end of the shooting of Biutiful, I was really like, I don't know how to say, like down, I would say, down within myself. Like,
we've always had this, as long as I've known you, as much as I know you from talking to you, but, you know, you have this very upbeat, very youthful energy about you, and watching this movie, you, it's almost like seeing you emerge as an adult yourself, in a way, like, it's a different Javier coming out of the end of that, because you're ready, you know, and I actually, I had a moment where I actually said, you're going to be like the greatest father ever. And then I heard a week later you were having a baby. And I was like, oh, okay, that makes perfect sense. But it just, it feels like you're coming of age in a weird way, and yet you've done so much before this.
Yes. Well, I don't know. I think that, and that's what I read in the script, and that's what I read in Alejandro's eyes when he asked me, do you want to do this?
Yeah.
I knew that from the very first moment I would say yes to that, we would go that far. But I didn't know how far was that until I was in the middle of it. And then I got scared because, and that's why it's important, friends and family. They really remind you who you are and what is your place in the world. And they don't get affected by anything else, nor the world, nor the goal, nor the failure. It's like they know you. And they were telling me, man, where are you? Where have you been in the last 2 months? And I knew I have to go that far in order to be honest to the character and to the and to the commitment that I pursued with Alejandro in order to show this man's journey, which is a huge journey as a man and of course as an actor, for be able to do it. Now, is there any other way to do it? I'm sure there is, and I'm not saying that this is the way to go at all. I'm saying that I have to learn, I guess, how to get there from a safety place, where I can really, I don't know, I don't know if it's possible even.
But something like Eat, Pray, Love, not a huge challenge, but, but then you go on to Terry Malick.
Yes.
And so is working with another director of Alejandro's level or in that range, has that is that experience different now that you've had this experience? Is the actual work different?
Yes, because I knew, and I remind myself a lot of times when I was doing Biutiful, that when you create, when you are a musician, a painter, or whatever, or an actor, of course you're going to touch difficult places of within yourself. But that pain has to be creative. In other words, there is no way you can create something out of pain and only pain. And especially for an actor, because otherwise you are blocking the character. You are putting so much of yourself that at the end is like a therapy. It's not an expression of art, of creation. It's like a therapy work. People don't need to see your therapy. People need to see the character's journey. So what I'm saying here is that I think after doing Biutiful, I learned how to be in a painful place, but only as the ground where I can jump to the character's imagination, to the character's life, to the character's journey rather than being stuck right. in the pain that I create. That's the important thing.
So that's what you brought to the next set?
Yeah. and I think that's where you see the creativity of an actor, where you go, okay, I can feel he's going through something, mm-hmm. but he's able to get out of that and go even farther, mm-hmm. rather than being stuck in his own pain, which for me, I don't right. care. I don't care about the actor's pain. I care yeah. about the character's pain. So when I did Terrence Malick, being that different because it's not so hard,
yeah.
the character, I had the joy of doing different things in a different mm-hmm. way, and I experimented them, and I went to the same place mm-hmm. from a different place, and I felt okay, I learned something right. after Biutiful.
So do you think that having that pain on your shoulder and going to that place was more attractive to you as a younger man when you were 20 and you were coming up
yes.
and you thought that's the way it is, that's what a great actor is?
Yes. Yes. Yes, that's the danger. When you're 20, you think you're immortal, first of all, and nothing is going to be able to break you in pieces, or mm-hmm. you think you're never going to die. That's why some 20-year-old people do crazy things. We all mm-hmm. we all have done it. And yes, it's like the painful thing is the worth it. Pain is worth it. Mm-hmm. Well, no. Pain mm-hmm. is not worth it. Pain can be a tool to make right. something worth it, but pain itself is not worth it. Mm-hmm. That's a very Christian legacy,
right.
the glorification of pain,
yeah.
where through that you will engrace yourself to another level. No, mm-hmm. that's a lie. You can, as an artist, work with pain mm-hmm. and pleasure and joys and images and music and sounds and tastes, but that's only one tool. That's not the tool
right.
to do something good. It's impossible. That's where I learned after doing right. Biutiful.
So what was the first attraction to you to acting when you were a kid?
Not the money, for sure. No, I don't know. My mother is an actress, and everybody in the family is actors, directors, producers, writers. I guess I remember my mother going on stage on the premiere of a theater, of a play, mm-hmm. and she was playing a queen, mm-hmm. Queen Elizabeth from Spain. But I don't know, minutes before that, I was with her on backstage, and she was like shaking and mm-hmm. she vomited out of nervous and fear. Mm. But 2 minutes after, she was on stage and she was a queen. That metamorphosis, mm-hmm. I was like six, seven. I was like, how did she do that? what has to be in somebody's mind to be able to overcome that fear, that physical fear that makes mm-hmm. you vomit? And be in a place where you are like in control and also transparent, vulnerable. Not mm-hmm. in control like a stone, but
right.
otherwise in control from the pleasure of being there and giving, mm-hmm. giving. I felt that was something amusing. Mm-hmm. And I guess that image has been with me in the moment where I said I want to try that.
So how old were you when you first tried it, really?
I was 5, only for a day. But when I was 7, I was doing a theater play.
Uh-huh.
Every weekend for 3 months in Spain, I mean in a public theater, I mean uh-huh. in a professional theater. It was a child play,
mm-hmm.
child's play, but done by professionals.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoyed it. And then really professionally I started when I was 17.
And what was that a film or a theater?
That was a theater, and then it was TV,
mm-hmm.
and then it was a movie when I was 20.
Did it come easily to you? Did it feel like it was coming easily to you?
Yes, but I did it harder. I put it, like, I choose the hard way to get there.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking about when you're 20, it's like I felt that I really had to do and give everything the more I could in order mm-hmm. to earn the place, because my family, because Bardem is a long, long distance of actors
mm-hmm.
that has been an art. Very respected in Spain, so I put that pressure on me.
Mm-hmm.
And now I enjoy it, and I am glad and honored to bring that surname with me. But in the beginning, it was like an obsession.
Did the United States part of it, when films started coming over here and you got to be known here, did that change any of it for you? I mean, I guess the cash flow was
Yeah, it's like a dream. I never, ever dreamt of being here and working with people like Woody Allen, Coen Brothers, or mm-hmm. having the chance to speak with Sean Penn face to face, those are things that were not even imagined when I was starting to work there. Mm. Actually, I think that the first day they give me an award for the first movie, Jamon Jamon, mm-hmm. they show Fargo on the place, on screen. Uh-huh. And it was with my first award, I was 21, I was so happy. And then I saw Fargo, and I was like, wow, man, that's another level. That's a different level, look at that. But I never thought, not even imagined, I never dared to imagine that one day I would like to be with the Coen, no. But it happened. So that's beyond my dreams, beyond my wishes. And I never really put the focus on, I want to get to somewhere in special, no. Mm-hmm. It's like, I always put the focus on the work, and I knew, and I know, that if you really put the focus on the work will take you to a different, to the next step, mm-hmm. you know? But if you are with the eyes in the wrong place, right. then you are not putting the eyes in the right place, which is the work.
So were there times when you were disheartened and thought it wasn't going to really work out?
No, I've been lucky in that. I've always had work in Spain since I started. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it passed like 2 years between work, two jobs, where I felt, oof, I should do something else because this looks bad.
Right.
But I always trusted in, no, rather than, I mean, of course I did like waiter, like uh-huh. Every actor in the world, I've been a waiter. But I put the money in acting classes. I knew that the more I learn, mm-hmm. The better for me in the future.
Because it's like shocking to show. I'll show people every once in a while the Alex de la Iglesia movie with your spike, with your, you know, stripe up the middle of your head and Rosie Perez running around.
Oh, yeah.
Like, this is the guy. it all makes sense. Before Night Falls and that, it was just like the perfect match.
Exactly. Because I sometimes say that a dream that I have as an actor is to be able, when I'm old or when I'm dead, that all the characters that I played come to my funeral and they will be in the same room and they cannot talk to each other because they don't have anything in common. That will be a nice dream. Like,
that's the goal.
Like, you've done people that are really different from each other in a way that they sit down and they look at their faces and they go, what can I talk about with this guy? Like, for example, Perita Durango and Before Night Falls, I don't think they can talk to each other.
Not in the same universe. And the hair, which has finally grown out. You have your own hair again. It's great.
Yeah, he's here.
Is that now behind you, or are you going to go
for the haircut of the Coens?
Well, no, because you were kind of known for different hair in every movie. That was one of your signatures. Have you moved on from needing to cut your hair in some crazy way for each film?
No.
Or was that never real? Was that just a circumstance?
No, it's circumstance. I never thought about the hair as something that obsesses me. But I do believe that it's important, the body language, I mean, our behavior, the way I'm sitting down now, the way I move my hands, the way you are sitting down, speaks a lot about us in a way that we are not aware of. And that's important to understand a character. Like, for example, in Uxbal, in Biutiful, there's a weight in that back. There's something, and there's also a chest that is going inward because he's not a man that is really expressive himself, and the whole journey is for a chest to come up and open, and the back to feel more relaxed because he has to give up. That says much more than some lines, and that's the work of the actor. That's why he's not on the page. That's why you need an actor for, to put that in flesh and blood.
Well, even in this case, they changed the frame of the film as they progressed, as Ishbal went through his story. To show the difference also, but it was in a subtle way, not, you know, flashing it to the audience, but the changes you make as you go along.
I don't understand that.
He actually changed the format from the...
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
We talked about it. He told me, and I said, that's going to be tremendously helpful for the both of us, because then you are not alone in the journey. I mean, you are working with the director to know that what you're doing is going to be recorded. In a good way, in the best way as possible. Because sometimes you do things and the camera is not there, so who cares?
Well, Prieto's a pretty good place to be if you're if you're going to be captured by somebody.
Exactly.
You know it's going to be okay. Did you was it important to you that the ending be, I mean, because Alejandro is very firm on it, and I think he's right, that the ending is actually happy mm-hmm. in a way, that it's a positive message at the end. It's a hard movie for people to watch a mm-hmm. lot of the time. But the ending is something positive.
Well, this distinction between positive and negative, I think, is too narrow. I mean, too simple to say what's positive and negative. I mean, we know what is wrong or right, good or bad. But I think this movie transcends that and goes to a mixed place where real life happens, which mm-hmm. is people are not only good or bad. I mean, there are some son of a bitches out there doing a lot of harm to people, but mm-hmm. most of the time we do wrong and we do right millions of times in one day. Mm-hmm. And that's Oxbal, and that's the movie. And at the end of the movie, what I think it is, more than a happy ending, is a place where you, as a viewer, feel like, I don't know, you feel empathy for the human being, for the human mm-hmm. soul, for how that person that you saw and his struggle took him to a place where you feel a redemption, empathy, compassion, and you know that what you feel towards him is what we have to feel toward ourselves and to the others. And that's a lot to feel for a movie, because I'm speaking about feeling, not thinking about it. Mm-hmm. This is not an intellectual journey, this movie. This is an emotional journey for the viewer.
It breaks you down. I mean,
it breaks you down, but also you want to go out of the movie theater and run and hug your people and remind them how much you love them and how mm-hmm. much, how important they are for yourself, for you, sorry. Mm-hmm. And that's something that is nice, I think. We are so much in the rush that we don't do that.
Yeah. Do you watch yourself?
No.
Ever? Do you avoid it?
I used to. I've been 20 years old, as I told you before. And it was like, hey, that's me, man. But then there's a moment where I can't take it anymore. It's like, I'm always saying that the need of performing doesn't have anything to do with the need of watching the performance. Mm-hmm. I went through a process. Somebody was there with a big guy putting on mm-hmm. on me, and that's done. That doesn't mean that I wanted to do that way, that's what I dreamed, that's what I planned. And that happened right there in that moment, and somebody caught it. I don't want to see that. That's for the people to see and see if they feel something about it or not. Mm-hmm. I mean, every movie that I do, I see it at least one time because I want to make sure that I am there, especially with Terrence Malick.
Well, you could be in version 1, 2, 4, exactly. 6, or 8. Exactly. You never know. It's, in the third cut, that's the big one. No, you have seven
scenes.
With
Terry, you don't know if you're going to have only one line or be the star of the movie.
Yeah.
So you never know.
And to go back and reshoot the scenes later, so it would be perfect. We went through this with The New World, uh-huh. where he delivered the movie and they had all these screenings, the Oscar movie, everything else. And then the second version came out. And then the third version came out.
Really?
And it was like, yeah. Okay. So, and it's lovely. They're all three great, but very different movies altogether. So you don't have do you have a sense of what you mean to people as an actor, how you connect with audiences? Or are you even, is it not something you can be worried about because it'll distract you from doing the work?
It's not me playing humble. It's really me feeling I don't really know what audiences will think of me as an actor, rather than what audiences will feel with certain characters that I play. After screenings of Biutiful, mm-hmm. I can tell people are moved by the global, by the performance also, mm-hmm. but that doesn't mean that they feel that about me as an actor. Mm-hmm. Did I explain myself more or less?
Yeah.
And I guess, if I have to say something that I think, is that I think people know that I am a person who really tries hard to do it as best, as good as he can. Mm-hmm. Like, I take seriously my job, which is good. But there are many, many great actors that also do that, so I'm not special. Mm-hmm. But at least I'm not a guy who just wants to be there for the wrong reasons.
When they hand you the bald gold guy, does that make you feel special, or is that just, I mean, I'm sure it's lovely regardless, but does it
maybe it's a
confirm?
It is. For the next 24 hours, it is. But on the 25th, you have to remind yourself, this was a lottery. Of course, the work has a lot to say about if they give the work the award to you or not. But it's more about you did something that touched people's hearts in a certain way, and they want to congratulate you and support you and thank you for that, and they give this to you independently of what they think of you as an actor. That is a beautiful accident that happened out of a job, out of one performance, not as the actor we love, you know?
Right.
And I think it's very healthy to remind yourself that is beautiful, you have to be grateful, an honor, it's a great honor, of course. But that doesn't mean that you are better than anybody else. Mm-hmm. As much as if they don't give it to you, you are not worse than anybody else. Right. You are who you are, and you try hard to be as good as you can.
So a movie like The Sea Inside, for instance, I felt was kind of a travesty that you were not nominated that year, and should have won that year, really, not just even been nominated, but it was just, that doesn't bother you, that doesn't stick with you?
No. No, because there are also in this nomination or winning thing, there are so many things that goes along with, and sometimes the work is the last thing that counts, you know? Which is to say, the support, the advertisements, the campaign.
Yeah.
How much the movie itself affects people has a lot to say about how much they reward the performance in the movie. So at the end, you have to be really aware of all those things to not feel like insecure about why they didn't give you anything,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And be like, okay, thank you. I mean, and taking it as good as you take the winning, you have to take the losing, if there is a losing part. Because I don't think not being nominated is not losing anything.
Right.
It's like, well, of course, if you are and they give you an award and they give you an Oscar, more people are going to see that movie. And because you are proud of what you've done, which is not to say I'm proud of me as an actor, but I'm proud of that we did this together. I think it's meaningful to people. If you have that thing, more people is going to see it. And then you feel like you are helping the movie in a way that it needs to be helped, which is come in and be welcome to it.
So you ready to do a musical comedy with Alejandro?
Yes, musical comedy with Alejandro. Well,
I think a musical in 3D.
In 3D,
okay. It's got to be the next thing, right?
All right, yeah, I'm in. With those glasses that the eyes pumps up in 3D.
It'll be perfect.